for a master, then 3 more years for a doctorate, approximately, 8 to 10 years. So you cannot understand like subject that are meant for people who are doing a master or a PhD if you're only doing college. This is the natural thing, yes. So you
expect us to stay for 10 years?
That should be the ideal, It will be the ideal, to master all this, yes. But what I'm saying is that Vedanta Sutra is at the level of a university. Maybe not PhD, but at least for a bachelor degree. Those who went to university, they know exactly what I'm talking about. Not college, not like high school. This is, you cannot keep this to high school, no way. People 14 years old, 15 years old, they won't be able to understand. I am an academic, I'm still teaching, and I was teaching, and I have a few diplomas. I don't put them on my wall, it doesn't matter. I'm not going to tell them. I'm not going to tell you what diploma I have. It doesn't matter. But all I know is that teaching is a little more a requirement. First of all, you have to be motivated. I want to take this course because it's going to bring me something. And second, there's assignments. There's a reading material. You have to read something for the next course, and then we can discuss it. Then there's also attendance. This is funny with devotees. Some devotees you just see once, and then they go. Sometimes they leave in the middle of the lecture. Sometimes they come, sometimes they go. It's not steadiness. And then the final exam. So I don't mind not having any final exam. Nobody takes paper, nobody reads anything. But it's very difficult. If you teach, if you preach, it's a different thing. I preach Vedanta, no problem. Preaching is a different thing than teaching. Preaching just means to enthuse people, into a subject. So you don't go into the detail. You don't go deep into the subject. You just go on the surface. Otherwise, people will get lost, especially when there's technical terms or technical understanding. Because I can guarantee any one of you, even if you say, I don't understand this, everybody can understand if they want to. I have a mother-in-law, she says she has no memory, and she's adamant, no memory. I cannot learn any shloka. I say, just repeat this shloka every day. And she learned how big verses like this, not that long. Because it's just, if you want to, so similarly for understanding. Understand some people really have no ability for anything that comes to abstraction. They're really down to earth and they cannot get anything. I'm not going to say any example. But still, if you really want to, you can grasp. Like I said, I read 3 times the Phenomenology of the Spirit of Ego. 3 times, big book like this, to understand what it meant. Because there was a requirement in the university. So it's not necessarily easy, but it's doable if one wants. So anyway, just to resume, Vedanta Sutra is short aphorism. Sutra means a line. It's a line where all the Upanishads teaching are thread on. It's a thread actually. Yes. Sutra is a thread and everything is like pearls on this thread. So they give what is the basic of the Upanishads. Upanishads are many, they are contradictory, they are mystical, they are mysterious, they are meant to be taught by a guru to a student who is a serious student. And so therefore it gives very short aphorism in order to understand what is the essence. It's like this morning we heard that the sage of Nemisharanya, they wanted to know the essence of all scripture, because there's many scriptures, so they asked the sutta, what is the essence of all the scriptures? And he gives this Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the essence of all scripture, including Vedanta Sutra. So it doesn't mean, oh, I read Srimad Bhagavatam, I don't need this subject, Vedanta Sutra. No, you read Srimad Bhagavatam, and if you want to understand how Srimad Bhagavatam is a commentary of Vedanta Sutra, then you need to know the sutra also. I can tell you, all the sutra are explained in Srimad Bhagavatam in the first 3 cantos and 11th canto. These are the philosophical aspect of the book, and a few others here, there, in the 6th canto and 5th sometime, and also in the 10th canto. It's not loud enough?
I don't know.
No, okay. Like this. Better? Like this? Better? Like, don't turn it too much towards the mic, because it's going to do this echo effect. You know?
There's not a button behind.
But your hearing is impaired.
Yes. Yes, it's true. Because people play karta in his ear too often, you know? Close to his ear, so he lost a little bit of the hearing. This is the problem. If you put it too loud, it's going to do this. You have to turn it the other way, because it's going to do this echo effect, you know? Like this. So, the sutra, you know, is they're very easy to learn. That's for memory, no problem. Just a few words, each sutra. Then the meaning of it is easy also to understand if you understand how they link with each other. Atato Brahma Jigyasa, now is the time to inquire about Brahman. What is Brahman Jamadiyasya Yataha? It is from whom everything comes, from whom everything is maintained, from in whom everything is destroyed. How do we know this? Shastra Yonitva, because Shastra is telling us. And what is Shastra? How do you read Shastra? Tattu Samanvayaram, meaning that you have to do some exegesis, right?
Exegesis.
You have to be able to examine the text and to make comparison between, oh, it says this in this book and this in this book, and how does it, like Gurudev was always saying, how to reconcile everything. And Ikshatel Na Shabdam, this Shastra are telling you the truth. It's not like the Godhead cannot be described. No, it is not true. Like, impersonally, Shankaracharya and his followers, they say, you cannot speak about what you call Brahman. Brahman is the absolute. It's transcending the concept of God. It's like an impersonal conception, force behind everything. So this Brahman cannot be understood by words, say Shankaracharya, and words can only give you indirect meaning, indirect description, lakshana. But Srila Madhvacharya, he says, no, this, the, actually lakshana is not needed. It is not describing any better than direct meaning, mukhya vritti, meaning the direct words. If it says that Brahman, Bhagavan is beautiful, it is not the lakshana, it is not indirect meaning. It means, really, Krishna is beautiful. That is all what it means, direct meaning. So in other words, Madhvacharya is giving something very new there, saying that Brahman can be described by words. To a certain limit, of course. I cannot describe the absolute beauty of Krishna. I can describe just a hint of, it compares, you know, millions of cupid, Gandhara Pakoti, and it describes how the three worlds are nothing more beautiful than this. So you cannot really understand or describe the complete beauty of Krishna, but his beauty is there, fascinating everyone, fascinating everybody. So the subject matter is still on this same topic, that Shastra can give the evidence, and this evidence is self-evident. Yes, it is, you know, Svatra Pramanya, within, you know, it's self-evidence. And this self-evidence describe the absolute Brahman, who is Nirguna, because impersonalists are saying that, oh yeah, with words you can describe Saguna Brahma. They make this distinction, these two kinds of Brahma, higher and lower. Higher Godhead, not Godhead, but higher absolute. There's a big absolute which is impersonal, and all the manifestation of the different gods in different religion, or in what they call Hinduism, it's just lower manifestation, saguna, with the guna, with qualities, mainly sattva guna. But Srila Madhvacharya and also Srila Bharadeva Vidyabhushana, they say no. Actually, it's not because Brahman is described as Nirguna. It doesn't have material qualities. It's completely devoid of sattva guna, what to speak of tamas and rajas. It is Shuddha sattva. And it is sattva-guna in the sense that he has the best qualities of the world. And how to describe this Brahman fully? He is the creator of the world, maintainer of the world, destroyer of the world, but even better, he is Anandamaya, or Purush. He is the embodiment of all Ananda. Whatever we are looking for as happiness, our goal towards life is happiness. We all want to be happy. Nobody wants to suffer. We are struggling to be happy. And we want to accumulate things, and we want to possess things, and we want to, we dream of whatever could make us happy. But Krishna is the source of happiness. He's the source of all beauty, and he's the source of all happiness also. He has the best qualities, he's devoid of mundane qualities, and he's supremely happy himself. He's happiness himself, and he gives happiness to everyone. And ras, raso vesa, this is also in the same Upanishad that described the Ananda Vali, the greatness of happiness, how happiness can be always multiplied by 100, and you get to a higher happiness, that of a human being, that of a god, that of a Indra, that of Brahma, and so on and so forth. There's a big long list. Actually, some people asked me for the copy I made, well, Prajna did, and both sides it was not needed. Okay, this has also the Bhrigu Vali. Yes.
So this Raso Vesa, Vesa, Raso Vesa, so Shankaracharya, you attribute this verse to Nirguna or Sadguna?
He doesn't quote that. He doesn't care for this. This is lore. To him, everything that is describable is lore.
Rasa is lore, is it?
Yes. Because it says, somewhere in Upanishad, it has no rasa, no gandha, no rupa, no form, no taste, no nothing. Even though it is the embodiment of sarva kama, sarva karma, sarva rupa, sarva ganda, sarva rasa, because this is a complementary.
It is one sutra.
I'm just saying that it is linked to this Anandamaya sutra. Actually, it's more than a sutra. It's a bunch of sutra we call adhikarana topic. So in this adhikarana, we can also, this ananda, because of repetition, everywhere in the Upanishad and Purana, you speak about ananda, brahmananda, paramananda, purnam brahma sanatanam, Krishna is described as paramananda. So you find this repetition everywhere, ananda. And also, one way of describing Brahman is sat-chitta-ananda, that is eternal, full of consciousness and full of bliss. So this Ananda is describing Vedanta Sutra as being describing fully the Purna Brahma. But Shankaracharya is saying this is not Purna Brahma, this is the lower Brahma. Saguna Brahma actually is pertaining to the Jiva. He even claims that this is pertaining to this, contradicting himself. I'm not going into all the details because you will feel again that this is some kind of boring philosophical discourse. And this is more interesting to read, actually. That's why I believe that in teaching, this reading material should be there, and then explanation should be done orally, so that all the heavy philosophical aspect are just written on paper. Otherwise, then you speak something which is unintelligible to people. People don't understand what you're talking about. And once they finish this topic of Anandamaya, then comes the, I call it analogy, but we can have a debate no more, that this is still in the first part of the first chapter. Chapters are divided in four chapters, each divided in four parts called pada. Pada means a part, this means a foot also, but it means a part. And the ending of this part, of this first chapter, is comparison or analogy with Aditya, the sun. Actually, more than Aditya, it's the person within the sun. The person within the sun is Brahman. This is the, you know, Aditya Varunatama Saparastat Etaham Eta Mahapurusham Aditya Varunatama Saparastat. This person, Mahapurush within the Aditya, is beyond darkness. And Iranmaya Purusha also is described. And then elements from the material world. Akasha means the sky or ether. Then Jyoti means light, and Prana means the inner breath. So I don't mind with a small debate that my god brother, he's saying Prasanatma. We have almost the same name, but you know, the Atma is the same, but it's one soul but two bodies. Yes, Prasanatma. Prasanatma means all satisfied. Brahma Buddha Prasanatma Nashoshati Nakankshati. In the Bhagavad Gita, he never doesn't lament, doesn't anger anything. And my name is Prakash Atma, meaning brilliant Atma or manifested Atma. Depends on the days. Anyway, he's saying Akasha, Jyoti, Prana, if I'm not wrong, I will let him speak. They describe the real Brahman. Whatever you see as a sky, this is Brahma. Whatever you see as light is Brahma. Whatever the breath in is Brahma. And I'm saying those are just indication of Brahma. I call them symbols, or you know, that there's something behind. So you can explain.
You want the mic?
Yeah, it's just a big subject because some explanation, it is said that those things are Brahman, and like you say, it is like a symbol, like it is being like a part of Brahman. So it is actually difficult, and Shankaracharya is very adept in, you know, like a fish, you know, going to one side to another in order to interpret. But there is something, I will say a little part of this is Brahman, like prana. You will explain later. Prana, what we have here, it's come from Brahman. It is explained. And it is not, the question is, what is prana? Is it air? It is something like air or something, another matter or something? No, the answer is, actually prana is Brahman, cannot come other place than Brahman. But in other words, also it's something different, it is not pure, it's difficult to really understand or grasp the idea. But like this, so in the same way also Akash, you know, this space, it is said is in the heart, there is a small space, it is called Adara Akash, a small space. Which is Brahman.
In the heart.
In the heart. And at night, the soul is coming, you know, and go to sleep in that small
space.
You know, Akash, small space in the heart. So we can say it is, because it is written like this. So, like Prabhu said, we can say it is like a symbol. What? No, we have to, something is there. Something is there in the heart, and it is Brahman. And actually, the Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, explained it is like a farmer who is working on his field every day, going back. He does not know that under the earth there is a big treasury, big chest with diamond and everything. But he does not know. In the same way, we don't know that in the heart there is Brahman. And every night the soul goes to sleep there, and morning wakes up, but it does not know that he has been acquainted with Brahman.
The soul is also Brahman.
And the soul is also Brahman.
It can be called. Sometimes it can be called Brahman.
Can be called. I mean, this small place like this, so like this, Upanishad is explaining how to understand that Brahman is part of us. That's what it is said, I'm Brahmasmi. I'm Brahman, and it is true. But not like Shankaracharya, that I am Brahman and I am like God. When I will become realized, and I will become God. That is craziness. But it is true that we are Brahmasmi, Brahman. So another nice example give, very easy example given in Upanishad. You want to know what is Brahman? Then block your ears. Do? Block your ears, two ears. Then listen. It's like a fire, like a small fire burning inside. Can you hear?
It's the sound when you're alone, you hear some whistle.
And this is indication of Brahman.
This is
the small song is Brahman.
That is a difference.
It's not Brahman.
Mm. It is not Brahman. That's the difference.
It's indication.
You put your finger on your eyes. And you push.
Very, very
some
hard.
Some ice coming. This is Brahman.
No, but I don't want to go into this discussion because I want to stay on the subject.
Yeah.
This comes later after for the, especially to understand the Atma within. But Jyoti now, light.
Oh. Can we stay?
Jyoti,
with
I don't know.
Can we stay?
I don't know what to speak about this. Yeah.
Can we stay for 1 minute with this space in the heart?
No, I want to come back on that later because it comes just after.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. This.
Physically, the sound you hear, it's the circulation of the
yes,
blood.
Yes, this is the scientific explanation.
It's a
yes, it is a scientific explanation.
But I want to stay on the Vedanta Sutra. Why they speak about Akasha, Jyoti, Prana? The question is asked, this is Purva Paksha, you know? I don't go systematically, but I told you that there are five stages of the discussion. First you have the subject that is proposed, Vishaya, then you have a doubt that is explained. First, for example, is Akasha Brahman or not? That is the proposal, according to Upanishad it says, okay? Then you have an objection, Samshaya. It says no, it cannot be, because, this is just a material thing, for example. And then you have a Purva Paksha, or yes, it is. Yes, Akasha is better that way. Yes, Akasha is the material sky. And you have the Purva Paksha saying that physical element is just mundane. Then you have the Siddhanta. Purva Paksha means the wrong answer. The first answer is always wrong. Then the second answer, after a thorough examination, is called Siddhanta. Siddhanta means Anta, the end of Siddha, the perfection, so the perfect answer. The perfect answer based on Shastra. So it says exactly, no, Akasha means Brahman. But the thing is that in the wording, so this question is asked, is this Bhuta Akasha, the material element, or Brahman? Understanding two ways. Like you said, when we referring to the sky, is this sky Brahman or is this sky just an element? This is one way of understanding. The second understanding is that Brahman, is it referring to the material sky or is it beyond the material sky? This is the way I understand it. It's not the same way of understanding. Like the Bhuta Akasha is an element created according to Kam Buddhir Mano, you know, in Bhagavad Gita, Kam Buddhir Mano Ahankaram Iti Yame Bina Prakriti Ashtada. You know, it's Kam means ether. So it is a material element. And Akasha that we see, as far as I understand, is the material element. But the Akasha that we refer to is something beyond this. We cannot see this beyondness. And the sutra that's saying Akasha Tal Lingat. Akasha Tal Lingat, if you translate linga by sign, because it can mean sign, it can mean a characteristic, but it's also a sign. Because the sign of Akasha. So sign is the symbol to me. And it is not a deity. Because otherwise you will worship the sky. If you say Brahman is the sky, then you worship the sky. Then secondly, you say about prana. You didn't speak about prana, but prana is one of the stages described, this anamaya. It's one stage. Pranamaya, second stage. Then manomaya, and it's always like go beyond, 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 beyond. Jyoti is the same way. In our Upanishad that I quoted the other day, the man is asking, actually the king is asking to Yajnavalkya, what is the light that shines for man that he can see? The first answer is the sun. Then when we say, but when there's no sun, where is the light? What is the light that will guide the human being? And they say, well, the moon. If there's no sun, then it's night, the moon. But if there's no moon, if there's no sun, there's no moon. So then the answer, logical, well, the fire, all the electricity, we have electricity. So then, again, if there's no fire, if the fire dies out, all the electricity, power, there's no more power, you have no sun, you have no moon, you have no fire, no electricity, what is the that is going to guide you? So the answer is the voice. Because when it's dark, I don't see anything, someone is calling out, he's standing there and saying, over there, I can be guided by the voice, this is the light. But when there's nobody there, when, and it can happen to you when you're totally alone, no sun, no moon, no light, no electricity, and then no people to guide you, what is the light that will shine for you and illuminate you? The answer is the Atma. So therefore, the light of the sun and the moon, of the electricity, is some inferior, some kind of something inferior. I find in Bhagavad Gita, this is in the 13th chapter. Jyotisham mapita jyotis tamasa paramuchate gyayam gyayam gyana gunya kamyam ridi sarvasya vishishtam. He's the source of light, you know, luminous object, is beyond the darkness of matter and is unmanifested. He is knowledge, he is the object of knowledge and he is the goal of knowledge. He is situated in everyone's heart. So the purport by Srila Prabhupada, the super soul, the supreme personality of Godhead is the source of light in all luminous objects like the sun, moon, stars and so on. In the Vedic literature we find that in the spiritual kingdom there is no need of sun or moon because the effulgence of the Supreme Lord is there. In the material world, that Brahma Jyoti, the Lord's spiritual effulgence, is covered by the Mahatattva, the material elements. Therefore, in this material world, we require the assistance of sun, moon, electricity, and so on, for light. But in the spiritual world, there is no need of such things. It is clearly stated in the Vedic literature that because of his luminous effulgence, everything is illuminated. It is clear, therefore, that his situation is not in the material world. He is situated in the spiritual world, which is far, far away in the spiritual sky. That is also confirmed in the Vedic literature, Aditya Varnam Tamasa Parastat. He is just like the sun, eternally luminous, but he is far, far beyond the darkness of this material world. In other words, if you say that light is Brahman, then you worship the light, the material light, but actually that light is just a reflection of the eternal Brahman. This is how I understand it. I'm not saying about Dahara Akash, this is a different thing. Dahara Akash, it says this is the place for Vishnu, is within the heart. This is coming in the sutra, for the help of meditation. It says that, so this is, after that we can come to it. Brahman is also described as Bhagavan, according to Jiva Goswami in his Bhagavad Sandarbha. Why is he making an equation between Brahman and Bhagavan? Because he's saying Bhagavan is the full explanation of Brahman. Brahman is just an imperfect explanation. And Brahman has no qualities. So you can say only describe it negatively. He cannot be seen, he has no hand, he has no form, he has no smell, he has no rasa, he has not. This is the impersonal. That's why when we speak about Brahman, devotees don't like to hear. It's very difficult to speak about Brahma Sutra because they speak about Brahman and they don't like to hear this. It should be called Bhagavan Sutra. But then Bhagavan Sutra is Srimad Bhagavatam, obviously, Bhagavat, about the Bhagavat. And Brahman is just the general, you know, but it describes also positively in the Vedanta Sutra how you can understand that within yourself there's a space okay, you can hear also the whistle, some indication is there, but this is more interesting because many Upanishads says compare the heart to a cave. People were meditating in caves before, you know, Buddhists or yogis, they were meditating in caves. And the heart is compared to a cave where you have to retreat in order to find a jewel, because it says in caves there are always jewels. And within the cave sleeps this Atma. And there's a Paramatma also. So the space within this cave is considered Vishnu, but I also will think this is more like Vaikuntha, the space of Vishnu, not Vishnu himself. Vishnu is there, Paramatma is sitting with the Anuatma and is guiding. And the space is Vaikuntha. And some other sutra in this first pada, first chapter says Purusha. Antaryami describes that this is also, this is a positive aspect. Antaryami, the witness, the guide within everybody, the consciousness, you may say. You know, sometimes people, they illustrate this by a little angel and a little devil. You know, the good consciousness is the little angel saying, do this, this is going to be good and everything. Then the bad one says, no, you better do this, you know, for your own pleasure. This is called consciousness. Everybody, every human being who has a normal
conscience.
Yeah, consciousness or conscience. You make a difference.
Yes.
Yes. Very different.
Yeah. Consciousness is cheap. And conscience is
moral.
Conscience is that little voice that's
it's the moral. Yes. The moral conscience is moral consciousness.
Okay. But this is like I said, I'm French, you know. Conscience is just one word.
Conscience in français is consciousness.
Yes.
But on English,
conscience. In German?
Conscience. Gewissen.
Gewissen and Bewusstsein.
So there's two words.
Yes.
Okay. Completely. Okay. Conscience. Okay. So this conscience is there to tell you that there's a, you know exactly what is you have to do or what. If you had a normal, good education, I have to use both words. Normal means in the normality of society, and good meaning relatively good, because you need both normal and good in order to have a good consciousness, conscience. But according to law, you are responsible for your actions. You cannot say, I didn't know. That is not a good answer. No law, no country will accept that. You're supposed to know the law. This is conscience. Yes.
You described the meditation of finding the Atma.
Yes.
Inside the heart.
Yes, the Atma and the Paramatma.
But
because now we're on the subject of Paramatma. Yes.
Well, I just want to address the Atma, because.
Okay.
So the meditation is for finding Paramatma, because we are the Atma.
Yes.
Right. So could we? So we're using the mind to see ourselves. Is that what the meditation is?
We can use the mind first, you know, as dharana, concentration. Yes, the mind has to be concentrated. First of all, you have to let go of all the things that disturb you to focus on something. But it's very hard to meditate on oneself. Zen meditation is just to be there, just be aware that you are doing nothing else but observing your thoughts. That's all. It doesn't speak about who you are, where you're going, if you are godly or not. Just be there. It's already one thing, one type of meditation. Most of the yogis, they try to meditate on some symbols. The Omkara is also a symbol of Brahma. Om is a symbol representing the full Brahma. And Jiva Goswami says A means Krishna, U Radha, M living entities, and the dot is the pradhan. Everything is including there. So they meditate on Om, or they can meditate on different other symbols, like this different chakra, you know, you can meditate on that, or you can meditate on Vishnu's form. As described in the Bhagavatam, actually it's describing right from the beginning of the answer of Shukadeva Goswami, when Shukadeva Goswami is answering, what is the duty of a man at all time, especially at the time of death? He's saying, very good are your questions, very few people ask this question, they're so busy asking so many other things, that he's describing the process of meditation, first of all, in the heart. Meditate on the super soul, and it describes the form of Vishnu. Because it's much easier and much more profitable to meditate on Vishnu than on yourself. If you meditate on yourself, you'll fall asleep. Since we are in following the very secret rahasya line of Shiva Gurudev, then I heard some misconceived idea that one should meditate on your Siddha Deha as a little girl, Manjari and everything. Okay, the woman can do more easily. If I meditate on myself as a little girl, I think there will be problems. Because we are not there. We have to hear first, we have to hear all this rasa, all this tattva, then nourish our souls, and then it will come naturally. You know, that's the difference between sahaja and this process. They say, the sahaja says, oh, you've been practicing for 30, 40 years, nothing comes. But within, for us in 1 week, you have all your siddha-deha, everything. But this giving of siddha-deha is very artificial. I don't want to make any controversy, I'm just saying. Just saying that you have to be faithful to the Guru. The Guru is not lying to you, he's giving you something that is very valuable. You have to follow, even if it takes time, because anatta are very deep ingrained in the heart. But you have to clear the heart. If you want to meditate on the soul, you first have to clear out chitto darpanam marjanam. Jai Maharaj, Hare Krishna. You have to clear the heart of all these misconceptions. So better to meditate on Vishnu. Or if you cannot meditate on Vishnu, then meditate on the Vishwarup. Purusha is within your heart, but is also including the entire universe. It includes actually what you cannot see, all this lower planetary system and the higher planetary system that you can read the description in the Bhagavatam. And you can have a grand vision of the entire cosmos. This is called for beginners. Those who cannot meditate on Vishnu, they don't have this appreciation for him, is described still by Shukadeva Goswami in his first answer to Parikshit Maharaj. You can meditate on this universal form which is containing everything. Why am I saying this? Because if you have this presentation I made, I call it negative theology and positive theology. So now we're not anymore in the field of philosophy, but theology. It's not necessarily easier to understand, because what is theology? It's a discourse about God. But major religion, I'm talking religion, not Buddhism. I don't know if Buddhism can be included in religion, philosophy, I don't know. But this is, doesn't describe God, so I cannot describe it as a theology. But major religion, they say that God can be described, first of all, negatively. Because he's beyond everything. He cannot be called a human being, cannot be called an animal, cannot be called the sky, or the light, or the prana, even though those things are so important for us. That's why they are indications for Brahman. I breathe. This breath, this breathing comes from God. I see the light. The light is guiding me. The sun is warming me. This is an indication of God. The sky has no limit, or so it seems. And this is the indication of the vastness of Brahman. But if I really want to describe Brahman, it has no really positive word. So it's called negative theology. And in the Middle Age, Thomas of Aquinas, he actually wrote in his big, you know, Summa Theological. Theological. It's very big, you know, very structured and everything, based on Aristotle's work and the belief of the church, he described how God cannot be described. He only negatively. Yes, funny, he writes a big thing to say that God cannot be described. But
so why are you describing it?
No, but also why writing such a big book to say that God cannot be described? But
there are those who are like, you cannot find God in any book. I mean, you have to read the book to understand that.
Yes. Oh, God has no form, but yet, you know, still worshipping some deity in the background and all sometimes. But anyway, it is not totally idiotic, you know. It's easy to win an argument saying, you stupid fool, you have no understood anything, you're making many mistakes. It's interesting also to see the arguments. that he's not saying that God is not knowable. That is a different subject. That is what Shankaracharya, but others will say, agnostic. Yes, they will say you cannot know the reality or the non-reality of God. It cannot be proven anyway, neither through scripture nor through natural theology. It cannot be proven. But this is called negative theology, meaning that you understand God, and he's saying, Thomas of Aquinas, through analogy, that the world is giving analogy of the Creator, and the words are improper to describe God. Because in biblical understanding, God cannot be a human being, cannot be a God, cannot be an angel, cannot be an animal, cannot be a thing, so therefore it is beyond everything we know. So therefore it can only be described as negative. So words like the use in Vedanta Sutra, Akshara, the imperishable, this Yajnavalkya again, too. I think his wife Maitreyi, no, to another woman. You were not there, but actually a woman could speak in public debate and tell the Brahmana, listen to this man, he has the real knowledge, and if you don't listen, problem will come to you. Because women could speak freely in Vedic time, you know, contrary to what we think, there was more freedom. Anyway, this is just a parenthesis, I'm closing it now. He replied to that woman that it is the imperishable, Akshara. And Brahman referred to it like this: it is neither coarse nor fine, neither short nor long. It has neither blood nor fat. It is without shadows, nor darkness, without air or space. It is without contact. It has no taste or smell. It is without sight or hearing. It is without speech or manjai, madhav, maharaj. It is without energy, breath or mouth. That is the imperishable. That is the imperishable Gargi, which sees, but see, this is the thing. First is described negatively. Then he's describing exactly the contrary. That is the imperishable Gargi. First he's saying, we're going to come back to this. What is a Brahmana? Without knowing this Akshara, Brahmana, Gargi, even if a man were to make offering to other, to do sacrifice, to perform austerities for thousands of years, all this will come to naught. Pitiful is the man, Gargi, who departs from knowing this imperishable, this proper, of course, you know, in Bhagavad Gita. But the man who departs from this world after he has come to know this Akshara, Brahma, he, Gargi, is a Brahmin. That is the definition of a Brahman, one who knows Akshara, Brahma. Brahman Jananiti Brahmana. A Brahmana is someone who knows Brahman. And then it goes on. This is the imperishable Gargi, which sees but can be seen, which hears but can be heard, which thinks but can be thought of, which perceives but can be perceived, and so on. I read this before. Anyway, this Akshara is a negative way of describing Brahman. But it doesn't mean that it is the only definition given. Do you have positive theology also? Other negative words used in the Vedanta Sutra in this part of the work is adrishya, it cannot be seen. And you can think of other words, avyakta, non-manifested, achyuta, he didn't come today. Why? Why achyuta didn't come? Achyuta means infallible. Advaitam, advaitam, achyutam, anadimananta rupam, Brahma Samhita is saying. But Vedeshu Dulabham Adulabham Atma Bhakto is revealed through the scriptures to the Bhakta. He's the oldest and the newest. He has both positive and negative theology. So this neti neti of Yajnavalkya, he's saying always that this is the only thing we can say about Brahma, that he doesn't, he's not. Nayetasman neti neti anyat paramasi. There's no other definition of Brahman than this, not this, not this. So impersonal is the very expert in answering you this. Neti 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 neti. Not this, not this, not this, not this. But Vaishnava, Both Ramanujacharya, Bharadeva Vidyabhushana, Madhvacharya, they all say this meti only means not material qualities, that's all. It cannot be defined by material qualities, it cannot be defined by mundane words, but mundane words can still describe him to a certain point, to understand his greatness, his vastness. If you say God is great, that is something that you can say, why not? But you cannot describe how great he is. You can only say he is great, or beautiful, or full of good qualities, but you cannot describe the full extent of his quality. So the second aspect is a positive theology. So you have theologian who says, no, God can be described, just like Madhvacharya was saying, God can be described. One way of describing it is Bhuma. Actually, this Akshara is also called Bhuma, the infinite. If you see infinity, this is the famous poems of William Blake, and hold infinity in your palm of your hand, and eternity in an hour. I forgot the rest, but it's, you know, but who's Mayava, they love this kind of thing. But infinity is a positive thing to describe God. God is infinite, and his attributes are infinite. The Antaryami, Purusha, Bhagavan, this also refer to the same thing. This is helpful for meditation. So the Dahara Akasha, the little space in the sky, in the heart, there's a little space in your heart. And in this heart, it is described that the Jiva soul is living, and within also, next to it, is Paramatma. It is also described in Bhagavad Gita, that this the soul and the super soul. By the way, also, the Akshara is described. Yitvakshara manirdesham avyakta puryupasate sarvatragam vashintyam cha kutastam acharam dhruvam. That those who want to take this meditation on the Akshara, the infallible one, anirdesha, indescribable, avyaktam, non-manifested, this is a very difficult path. It's a very difficult path. Krishna is saying, the 12th chapter, talking about devotional service, bhakti, how bhakti is such easier than all this hard meditation on avyakta, akshara, adrishya. And sometime in the same verses of Bhagavatam, it says that he has no mundane quality, but he has all good qualities. It says also he has no hand, no feet, no legs, but he can go everywhere, sees everything, he can understand everything. And it says, Ashakshu Harupa, Aganda Arasa, but also he's Sarva Karma, Sarva Ganda, Sarva Rasa. It is described like this in Upanishad. If you don't read Upanishad the correct way, or if you only read Chandogya Upanishad or Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, like Shankaracharya mainly is doing, then of course you come to the conclusion, Aham Brahmasmi, Tatvamasi, because these are in this kind of Upanishad, Sarva Kalpa Vidam Brahma, they are all in this kind of Upanishads. But if you read the Mundaka Upanishad, Shvetashvatara Upanishad, Katha Upanishad, then you have a theistic approach. Katha Upanishad is describing directly Vishnu, the Lord Vishnu, Paramam Padam. It is describing the ultimate place of Vishnu. Shvetashvatara Upanishad is saying that there is one personal God, he's called Hara, sometimes Shiva, sometimes Rudra. So you may say, well, this is a Shivaite Upanishad. But if you understand correctly Vedanta according to Madhvacharya, in his Anuvyakana, it is a small contribution to the Vedanta Sutra, besides his commentary, the main commentary called Sutra Bhashya, he wrote another sub-commentary where he describes that all words of the Vedas and Upanishads and Purana and Tantra and everything only aim at Vishnu. Vishnu, Hari is also Hara, he's also Maheshwara, he's also Mahesh, the Supreme Lord. He's also Brahma, Hiranya Garbha Brahma, he's also Indra, Mahendra, the great God. actually in this installation of Govinda, you know, Indra is recognizing this is the new Indra. When this Govardhan incident is
Govinda Kund.
Yes, at Govinda Kund, then Indra is recognizing this is the new Indra. Before Indra is being quoted in the Rig Veda. 3/4 of the Rig Veda is concerned with Indra, then Agni, then Soma, a little bit about Vishnu. There's the three steps of Vishnu, there's the Purusha Sukta, there's a description that you may count all the particles of earth on this, all the particles on earth on this entire planet and the whole universe, and you will not be able to describe all the glories of Vishnu. This is a verse that reoccurs so many times in Srimad Bhagavat to describe the greatness, the badness of Vishnu. That is an example of how it is inconceivable, Ashintya. It is unending, indescribable. The qualities of Vishnu are so vast, they cannot be described in full. But the skill still can be given a hint that we relish hearing about Krishna and his Leela, and it's always ever fresh. Even though we heard the story so many times, there's always some new realization, some new way of presentation, because this is not the same as relating your memory when you went on vacation and you show your friends all the slides that you've taken, and this is me and my family and this and that. How many times can you do it? And if you ask the audience, they're just watching to please you, but they're really bored to death. But Krishna's stories, you can always, all the time, hear the same story, and it's ever fresh. If you remain a devotee, of course, if you're interested in this anirdesha, avyakta, you know, akshara brahma, then you may lose interest, because the people who are captivated by impersonal Brahman, they find no sweetness and no happiness in the description of Krishna. They think it is just childish stories. Unfortunately for them, because they don't know, you know, aho bhagyam aho bhagyam nanda gopa vrajekasam yam mitram paramanandam purnam brahma sanantanam. That it is purnam brahma. Or that yesterday when he was meditating, when Narada Muni told him that he saw the purna purush and his maya, he saw the whole thing encapsulated, you know, within four verses of Bhagavatam, he saw the whole thing. It is describing the same Brahman. Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavaniti, Shabjate. But it's a gradation. And if you want to understand fully Brahman, then you have to understand Bhagavan. You have to understand how Brahman actually is a person. And Srila Prabhupada was giving often this idea of, you know, like if you're very, very far away, you see a mountain and you can see the mountain, you know, how small it is, and you can see it from one point of view, but if you come closer, you can distinguish, you know, the shrubs and the vegetation, everything that is on it, and if you climb on it, then you can see even better, you can go into a relationship. The whole idea of sambandha. Sambandha means relationship. So this Vedanta Sutra and Srimad Bhagavatam and every Vedic literature is based on three things according to Srila Jiva Goswami. Srila Jiva Goswami Pad in this Tattva Sandarbha explains very nicely how it is divided in Sambandha, Abhideya, Prayojana. So in Vedanta Sutra they call it, the Abhideya is called Sadhana and Prayojana is Pala, the fruit of Parama Purushartha, the supreme goal of human life, but it's the same thing. And if you understand this, then the two first chapters of Vedanta Sutra out of four describe Sambandha. Then third chapter, Sadhana, what is the process to achieve Brahman, and then Pala or Parama Purushartha, Prayojana, how it is described, Moksha, doesn't talk about Prema. Even though Srila Bharadeva Vidyabhushana is of course hinting at this. He's speaking about Ruchi Bhakti leading to Prema Bhakti. But then if we come back to Sambandha. Sambandha means relationship between different things. Essentially three things. Brahman, the Jivatman, and the world, the Jagat. How they interact with each other. But first of all, you have to understand each individual item. How can you understand the relationship if you confuse Atma with Brahma? Or if you confuse the world with Brahma? You have to make these distinctions, how what comes from Brahma, what is Atma, what is the specific characteristics. That's why the first part of Vedanta Sutra, even though it may seem a little tedious and a little boring, because it doesn't describe Krishna with the flute, playing with his friend and enjoying with the gopis, it describes only some characteristics of Brahma in a positive or negative way. But first you have to establish this. You have to understand what is Brahma. Then you can understand what is Atma. And then we're going to come to that tomorrow. Maybe I will give us, you know, a small presentation of what is the Atma within, and how it is different from Brahma. Because otherwise you confuse the two. Sometimes Brahma is called Atma in the Upanishads. In the beginning was this world, Sadeva, Somya, Sadara. The Sat was there and it was in the form of Atma. In the beginning was only Atma. And the Atma was thinking, may I become many. They call Bhavushyam. So sometimes it is called Atma. But this Atma cannot be the small individual Atma. How can you pretend you were there in the beginning when nothing was there and you desire to create? What pretension is there in you that you can think that you are the creator of this world? So in other words, this Atma refers to the Paramatma. And sometimes the small Atma is described as Brahma. It is described that Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahma. This Aham Brahma only means, Srila Prabhupada was always telling us, I am spirit soul. Tattvamasi, there is no difference between me and the source where I am coming from. But I am not he. Soham asmi, same thing. All this are just reference, because there's so many reference also to the other. This in the Shweta Shvatara Upanishad, it says clearly, Anya, in this two birds sitting in one tree, there's another. I gave that example, you know, that there's another one, this Anya, other reappear many times. This is a repetition, you know, and how to analyze a verse. It comes all the time. This someone else. And Krishna is saying in Bhagavad Gita, this another parable, the another witness, you know, this two. Yes. So this another kshetra. Know that there's another kshetra nowhere of the field that knows all the fields. How can you know, how can you pretend that you know other people's field? Sometimes we play a little like psychologists, and I know your problem, I understand everything you feel. No, you don't. You can just guess, because you live something similar, or you read something. If you want to play psychologist, the best way is to hear. That's the hardest. Not to say anything, to hear. And try to understand and be compassionate. And that's difficult, because we always identify with our problems. Yes, yes, I understand. No, you don't. If you don't listen, you don't understand. And every case is different, even though there might be a similarity. So everybody knows this kshetra. Sometimes doesn't know very well. So like the kshetra is like a battlefield. Sometimes it's a nicer area, but sometimes it's like a battlefield. But there's a Paramatma knowing also. He's the other one who knows everything. He's the witness, the Upadrashta Anumantasha. Yes. Paramatmati Shapi Yukto Dehismin Purushakpar, something like this. There's there's another one who lives here, and he's Paramatma. So that is clearly described. The Purusha is clearly described in many Upanishads. This Purusha is like, same thing. Purusha can be with a big P or with a small one. That means the great Purusha, the Purusha that creates all the world, the Purusha that embodied the entire world as a material creation, because of course meditating on the cosmic form, Shukadeva Goswami is saying this is made of material elements, it is not supreme. It is stula sharira, the gross form. Not the Skata, he says to meditate to the Purusha within the heart. If you have some devotion, better to meditate at the Purusha within the heart. But if you have no devotion, you can see the world as a play for the big Purusha. So it is described in the Upanishad. All these things are described. Angusta Matram, it speaks about the little if you are ever interested, you will read again this first part and you will find all the sutra I'm talking about. You know, it follows, you know, the Aditya, then Akasha, then Prana, then Jyoti, then you have the Adhara, Akasha, then Purusha, then Bhuma, then Adrishta, then not in this order necessarily, Akshara. You'll find, because I didn't want to follow the order and give you sutra by sutra. This is will be too tiring for everybody, and you will not necessarily follow. I just want to give in a nutshell how what the first pada is describing, because it's about time. I did it last year. I did it again this year. I want to complete one chapter at least. You know, I don't mind going over certain point, but we also have to go a little further. Yes, a story in Upanishad, Kena Upanishad, I didn't read it again, but just from memory. The gods have won the battle against the demons. And then this entity comes to them, which is unknown and visible, and is asking all the gods, it manifests as a straw, yes, but it can speak. And it asks all the gods, yes, because this is unspeakable, but still can speak to us, and probably through the mind, not through words, you know, because speech can also be through the mind. Before you express an idea, you have something in your head. Sometimes you can guess what someone is saying, or you can even say it at the same time as that person, because words, before they are spoken, they are mentally. So the gods, they don't need always to speak out with their tongue, they can also hear mentally. That's why they are called deva, they have a subtle body. So they can hear this genie talking to them, and every god comes. So I think the first god is Agni, because he's the god, major god in the Rig Veda, and asking, can you burn me? The little straw, can you burn me? So he tries his mighty best to burn this little straw, but he's not successful. And he admits defeat, I could not burn this, what they call it, jinn or genie, something. Yaksha. This yaksha, I couldn't burn this yaksha. Then another god comes, the god of wind, Vayu. Can you blow me away in a physical sense? And he tries all his best and he cannot do, and he accepts defeat. And then finally Indra comes and he claims that he has seen, because the straw is there. You know, and there's a play of word with seeing, you know, in Sanskrit. But this yaksha disappear from his sight, showing that actually this force that is behind this little piece of straw is the same force that helped them to overcome the demons. But they were too proud. They start thinking, we are the doer, we did everything because of us, because we were strong. They forgot that actually, well, Madhvacharya is calling this yaksha Vishnu. Of course, he's seeing Vishnu everywhere. This is the typical sight of Uttama, actually. Uttama Adhikari is seeing Krishna, Vishnu everywhere. So Madhvacharya is seeing Vishnu everywhere, in every words, in every stories. He's saying that, oh, this is Vishnu's working. This is not Brahman, impersonal Brahman. Won the fight because Vishnu is known to win the fight for the gods against the demons and to always protect the devotees. So this is one way you can say that God is Adrishya, is not seen, but actually behind is seeing Adokshaja. This Aksha is the eyes, Adha is above, so he cannot be seen. Yes?
From where come from the story?
Kena Upanishad. Kena means, it's a question. It's also maybe Jivadharma, it's always quoted in different. Because Amnaya means all the scriptures, that the Guru Parampara fits interesting to repeat, so they quoted in different places. Prabhupada also was quoting different stories. And sometimes we remember better by stories than by exposé, because, like, again, this is a little dry. So this is like the first pada and the second, almost at the end of the chapter. This one last thing, it speaks about the gods, how they can meditate on Brahman. There's a question, can gods also meditate on Brahman? The answer is yes, of course. But I'll skip through this. Next time I want to speak about the soul. This is the second chapter, actually, at the last, the fourth part, really. Because it's interesting to see the connection and the disconnection between Brahman and Jiva, Jiva Atman. The disconnection meaning the difference. This Beda Abeda. We have to know the resemblance and the difference. And then you can clearly understand that this equation, Atma is Brahma, is a misunderstanding of reading. That sometimes this Atma means Paramatma, sometimes Brahma is taken in the sense of being the Jiva, but we should not equate the two. That this actually is always a difference, and Shankaracharya is missing all these points where it says Veda. Actually, the word Veda comes many times in sutras. Veda or Vishishta or different way of seeing that there is a difference. So the next time I want to speak of the Jiva, and then Brajanath allow me to have a last course also on Wednesday. I want to bring the subject of the first chapter, speaking about the Shudra. The question is, are Shudras qualified to read Veda? Because it's an interesting understanding of what Shudra is and what is a Brahmana. It's important to understand this. And I made a few photocopies of this Taittiriya Upanishad. It's a Paramananda Lali and a little bit of the Bhrigu Lali. This is the inquiry into forms of bliss. What is 100 times the human bliss? That is one bliss of human man. Also a man who is well versed in the Veda. What is 100 times the bliss of human beings? That is one bliss of divine, well, it says fairies, but divine beings, you know, the Gandharvas really.
Maybe you can translate.
Yes, but you have the Sanskrit here.
No, but the English also is very complicated.
Yeah. Yeah, but you're intelligent. But it says, you can read the Deva Gandharva, Deva Karma Devanam. You can understand. Prajapati means Brahma. So whoever wants, I have like 10. And on the other side, it was not needed, but it's still there. The inquiry, the knower of the bliss of Brahman is safe from all fear. Bhrigu Vali. Bhrigu approaches his father Varuna. And then you have this Yato Vaimani Bhutani Jayante Yena Jatani Jivanti Yat Pravanti Abhi Sam Vishanti. This is what Jamadhyasya Yataha is based on. Everything comes from him. This is only 10. It's better that people who want to take it, because otherwise there will be a big fight. No, there's only 10. Only 10. So those who want... Yes, I know. Bamara Bamaraji asked for one. Anyway...
Should we walk up, or how do we show up?
Yes. There's any question? Everything is clear? Wow. Maharaj, you have any comment?
Nothing is clear.
Nothing is clear.
Chakravarti and Gandhi. What we are discussing today, Java Ajadacharam, Abhijitva, Asman Lokan Praiti, Sarkipana, Adare, Java Ajadacharam, Vijitva, Asman Lokan Praiti, the Brahmana. In this, as before also a body class, this Gargi is his wife or any other lady?
She's not his wife, that's another lady. Lady is Katya, he has two women, Katya and Maitreya.
Yeah. But somehow it mentioned, Katyani asked this question.
No. Gargi.
Yes, Gargi. Yeah.
Yes. Katyayani is the one who wants the wealth, and Maitreyi wants to know why. If you're living in the forest, there must be something more interesting. Tell me. And he's answering Atma Tattva.
Yes.
We'll can see tomorrow also this Atma Tattva. Because in the Bhagavatam 10th canto, it says that Krishna is the soul of everybody, that's why everybody loves him. Supreme Atma, everybody loves the soul, meaning loving Krishna.
When you ask me, cannot put it like that, I forgot. And only so many people who forgot.
Yes, this is the nature of
my course.
Because you need to. You lost this?
No. In my university.
University, you learn all this and you forgot.
Yes.
And definition of learning is to always learn what you have forgotten. Because already today our memory is on a stick or in a computer. If you lose this, you lose all your memory. But you have a good memory, Maharaj, don't worry. I always have this, especially the sloka. I'm used to know this sloka from Bhagavad Gita. All this sloka that Gurudev is giving us, very long, always have to learn again and again and again.
This is to keep it on your heart drive. Remember, keep it on your heart drive.
Yes. So it's close to your soul.
Heart drive. That's good.
It's all the time.
Right.
Anything else?
Yes.
Maharaj first.
No, you said that in another class. You're going to speak about that sloka which describes what is a brahmana and what is a shudra, the one that was just quoted by Madhav Maharaj?
Yes, the day after tomorrow, Wednesday. Based on this, the answer will come based on this book by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati, Brahmana and Vaishnava. Because it's a very good presentation. Prakriti Kanda, Arijan Kanda, very good.
You said that all this neti, is not actually is boring, and the people
just
lose the time. Is it not a part of a big plan, a big change that actually it was Shankaracharya came to make the people boring and also advance the Kali Yuga? I heard this, I don't know.
No. Because Shankaracharya didn't write the Upanishads, and Shankaracharya was only addressing Brahmana. He was not addressing anybody else. According to Shankaracharya, no one can attain Brahma unless he's a sannyasi, and nobody can be a sannyasi unless he's born in the family of Brahmana, which means very little people. So there was like very fixed rules, according to Shankaracharya. And you had already, he says, all the prerequisite before learning Brahman. You need to already have being completely detached from material things, have viveka, this be able to discriminate, then desire for liberation, mumukshu, and so on and so forth. But Srila Bharatiya Vidyabhushana is saying if people have those qualities, they will not be inquiring about Brahman. They will already be in Brahman. So it's impossible. So the difference between Srila Bharatiya Vidyabhushana in the introduction and Shankaracharya is saying, now that you have come in contact with the sadhu, then you can inquire about Brahman, because it is only through the contact of the sadhu that you can inquire properly about Brahman. Otherwise, your inquiry is just curiosity. Nothing else, nothing more. And if you have all the achievement, if you already have this equanimity, if you already Brahma, Buddha, Prasanapana, Shoshati, Nakangshati, this type, then why do you need to inquire about Brahman? You already have attained Brahman. So Shankaracharya is not making it easy for us. But once a disciple came to Prabhupada and he said, I cannot understand this point of Shankaracharya. And Prabhupada answered, very good. Because he doesn't want us to become impersonalists. But at the same time, and you reminded me of this, Srila Prabhupada, he said, unless a disciple of mine is able to defeat all the point of Mayavada Buddhism, he's not my disciple. Because after 2 years of being a devotee,
you are not able to
defeat
Buddhism and
Mayavada, you are not my disciple.
Was very strict.
Yes, and he was preaching all the time, defeating all the mundane materialist arguments and Mayavada, Nirvishesha Shunyavada. Very great work he has done. So if you are not capable of defeating all the arguments that come from Buddhism and Mayavada, then Prabhupada said you are not my disciple.
So, but in Vedic times, defeat meant that the defeated one becomes your disciple and accepts.
Yes.
This is a real defeat. Not
yes, that is a Vedic time, even Shankaracharya's time.
Not put
yes,
hand
but that comes from Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati was very bold. And he said this is the only way to preach in this age of Kali, because people argue all the time. And Prabhupada also was very bold. He was saying this story. He was saying this story that there are two people who are arguing about what cuts the best. One is saying the scissor, and the other one say the knife. So they argue back and forth, quoting many shastra and trying to prove with evidence and logic, but they still don't manage. So they come to fight physically. So the person who thinks that the knife cuts better, he takes the other one, throw him in the water. And the other one who thinks that the scissor cuts better, he doesn't know how to swim, so he's drowning. But because he's so attached to being right, as he drowns, you only see the hand sticking out, and he goes like this before drowning, you know, making this, I'm right, the scissor. So in other words, Prabhupada was giving that example to some devotees who were going to preach to scientists. He said they're never going to listen to you. They will argue back and forth, and you have to be using this kind of strong, bold preaching. Madhvacharya also was doing this. Because in the age of Kali, people are not honest enough. You know, the big Dvija Pandit, he submitted to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu after he accepted defeat. But many people, they don't accept defeat. They're just rascals. They just want to argue and argue and argue. And you have to corner them, so to speak. Not being insulting, but being very strong in your statement. And of course, it is an art also. You cannot offend people. But this is how it is done. By Srila Prabhupada, nobody could stand up to what he was saying. Srila Prabhupada or Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami, same mood. If you read, you know, Beyond Nirvana, he's really like, I translated this. I had to take out some of the really strong statement because it's just too much for modern people to take. But at the same time, to show that Shankaracharya is contradicting himself all the time, and then Buddhism, he doesn't speak so much about Buddhism, but he says that Mayavada is a form of cover Buddhism. And it's not always easy to translate because it's not actually a book written. It's a series of conferences that are being put together, so sometimes there's repetition. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur also, very bold in his preaching, defeating all this so-called Brahmana, all this Apasiddhanta, all this Mayavada. You're surrounded by wrong philosophies. This seems right, but if you are trained properly by the proper guru, your mind is clear about doubts. Ultimately, we have to understand Anyapilashita Shunyam for ourselves. But how can we answer Jnana Karma, Jnana Kritama? How to be free from Jnana Karma and Adi and the rest? Only if we understood correctly what is the proper Siddhanta and about Brahma, Bhagavan, Paramatma, Maya, Rasa, Jiva, all these things. Gurudev was saying, you'll come to Rasa Tattva more easily to understand if you have understood what is Maya. Because otherwise you read Rasa Tattva, you don't know what is Maya, or is describing about God loving all the girls. I also love all the girls, no problem. So therefore I understood, you know, you can kiss each other, you know, because Krishna is doing this, so this is like an encouragement. If you don't understand what Maya is, then you confuse the two. Yes, that's what's called Prakrita Sahaja.
No?
Prakrita Sahaja means materialist imitators. Yes? Oh, you have something. Yes.
We were talking about how people these days often won't accept defeat, even if they have been defeated. But a nice thing I found is that if there's anyone listening, even though the person you're speaking with doesn't accept defeat, those that are listening can hear the truth.
If you speak to a crowd, yes.
Well, even sometimes it's just a few people, but...
But if you speak to an individual, okay.
So what do you recommend then if you're speaking to an individual that is not accepting defeat?
There's no need to talk to someone who doesn't want to listen to you. Krishna says it's an offense to teach, you know, like confidential matter or the holy name or to someone who doesn't want to believe. Just Hare Krishna, that's it. To a crowd, when the crowd is a little dissipated, Prabhupada was saying, you just chant Hare Krishna, you give them some prasad. There's no need to argue back and forth. If we argue with the professor or someone in front of everyone, it's because other people listen, like you say. Never mind about the big pundit. He will start thinking on his own, you know. If he's a little sincere, he will see the... Anyway, Prabhupada could do things that we couldn't do, you know. He will say to a rich member, life members, a rich man in Bombay, you know, he was asking him, what is the first thing you do when you wake up in the morning? So that rich man, he says, when I wake up in the morning, then I go to the bathroom, then I clean myself, then I take a shower, and so on and so forth. So Prabhupada says, well, so what is the big deal with this? Even a pig does that. You're not doing anything spiritual, you're just wasting your time. How can you preach like this? You want to imitate Prabhupada, you may offend people. It's true, yes.
No. Prabhupada was very pleased also with the preaching of one of his disciples on Sadhuta, in Sri Lanka, because it was Mayavadi speaking with him, you know. At the end, on Sadhuta said, so we are all one, the guy said, yeah, of course, well, everything is one, everything. Okay, if it's everything one, I need your money in your pocket, please give me.
Give me your wallet.
Because, no, that is not one. So I told this argument and Prabhupada was very happy. He was laughing. He defeated.
In the early 70s, Prabhupada instructed Hridayananda to go to the university, like in Florida especially, and to stand there on the campus and to put out a challenge, like publicly, that anyone come here and tell me what is your philosophy. So, you know, on a university campus you have some persons who are very proud, they're intellectuals and so forth, and then they would come. And Prabhupada instructed him, he said, first of all you ask the person what is your philosophy, and you carefully note down in your mind what is the flaw in the philosophy, right? And then, when you begin to debate with the person, then you point out again and again what is that flaw, because the person will try to steer away from that, you know? They'll try to avoid addressing what is the actual flaw. And so then, finally, you corral them into admitting that, yes, this is a flaw, and that's the way you defeat them. Because he said it's like a mathematical equation. If there's one single fault in the entire equation, the whole equation is wrong. So he said in philosophy also, there cannot be one single flaw. That's why the Vedic philosophy is perfect, it's flawless.
Yes, very good point. If you can use logic and be, you know, listen carefully, and you can see, you know, this point is off. Okay. Yes.
If we're not qualified for this approach and try to imitate, the danger is we become proud, and we will not succeed in melting his heart.
Yeah.
Which should be basically the purpose of our preaching.
Now, preaching is a learning process also. You know, you learn how to preach by preaching. You make mistakes at first, then you become more expert. And only the Uttama is really perfect preacher when it comes down to the level of Madhyam. Even Madhyam Adhikari can still make some people upset without wanting to. You know, Prabhupada sometimes was yelling at people. You know, once they said this guru, you know, Maharaj is something, he's God's whole prophet, not yelling, he's not God, he's a dog, D-O-G, the opposite. Then it was written in the newspaper, you know, Hare Krishna master is calling, you know, the people from other groups dogs. He even said stronger words, which I'm not going to repeat, you know, but he was, yeah, very bold.
It happened also when Buddha was preaching in Australia, Buddha called someone dog, and they came in this country and did a full picture, the face, and name is Akito. And we can follow in liberated soul, not imitate. If we imitate liberated soul, dangerous for us. We can follow them, not imitate.
Just like Shiva, he can swallow entire poison.
Buddha, when he came to America, especially, he was stressing.